Mayor Coppinger's coming in from outer space, you guys. Y'all hearing that? Oh, there you are. Hello, Mayor Coppinger.
I wondered what that was.
I think it was your spaceship landing.
You're muted, Mayor.
Okay. Then I'm going to have to walk to another place. Still muted.
No, you're not muted.
Chair.
We can hear you.
Okay. Okay. As I was saying, again, special thank you to everybody that's joined this morning, and we're all in different locations, but again, you know, respecting the social distancing, and just want to make sure people are aware of what it is that we're, if you happen to be tuned into this live stream, today is we're going to hear the presentation from the Department of Education about their portion of the budget. Next week on Tuesday, same time, same location, live streaming. Will be the county general government's portion of the budget. And then on the 26th, it'll be both budgets put together and hopefully taken into the commission on the 27th, giving the commission, you know, a month to look at it before they act upon it in terms of voting. I think it's extremely important that as we go through these workshops that, you know, that we're looking at the budget, everybody knows that these are real difficult times. It calls for a lot of discussion, and we've begun those. I've had an opportunity to speak with commissioners about our portion of the budget. I know that our finance team has worked with the school board, not with the school board so much, but with the CFO, Brent Goldberg, and with the superintendent, Brian Johnson, in trying to help with looking at projections and where we're going to be. I just want to remind people, because I saw some of the comments that yesterday that they came out of the school board discussion. You know, what's really unique about Hamilton County, in a good way and in a bad way, there's two main sources of revenue for Hamilton County. For example, I mean, there was some, you know, some criticism about why is county government not doing what some of the other counties are doing as it relates to budgeting for less money? I just want to kind of tee this up before it gets started. Well, we only get some property tax. And as a reminder, on the property tax last year, we only got $4.8 million. We're not heavily reliant upon that. Other municipalities, particularly, you know, of the $8.5 million we got for a hotel, see any decline there because we didn't get it. It goes to the Convention and Visitors Bureau to recruit businesses. So obviously we're not going to see where the revenue be less there. What we do know, the tornadoes did destroy it was over 500 homes that were totally destroyed. We do know that we brought on over 900 new homes on the tax roll. So if you're looking at ours, and our budget's going to be pretty flat, showing no increases in property growth or sales growth. And the other thing I remind people is what we didn't have 2 years ago that we now have is internet sales tax. So obviously, you know, we do have some additional revenue that are coming in. So as we go through this budget season, and again, I want to say a real big thank you to all of the finance people, particularly at the Department of Education today, and certainly within county government. I mean, these people get up every single day looking at budget numbers and making certain that we're going to make budget. The times are predictable, are totally unpredictable right now, But I will say this, you know, because some of the other comments that I keep hearing is, you know, when you're talking about projections of people saying, you know, how do you, why are we not getting hard numbers? Why are these projections? Well, I know this group knows that every year budgets are based on projections. There's no, you know, certainty about, obviously this year is a good example. There was no prediction last year when we were doing this budget that there was going to be a COVID-19 virus or tornadoes that's going to put us, you know, with less revenue here in the last quarter for sure. But we can't predict what's going to happen next year either. So I just want to say that. And again, I've got a lot of confidence in what I do as well in what these finance people do, you know, again, each and every day. And I'm confident that they don't want, you know, any egg on their face either at the end of next year. And then there's some things that I think there may be some opportunities where we're really under budgeting that we can look at maybe in January and see where we are when the revenues start coming in. The one last thing I'll say, and the finance people are more equipped to talk to this, but you got, as we go through this process too, remember, you know, that the projections that are going to, that we're seeing coming out of, whether it's Department of Education or whether it's county general government, there's kind of a misnomer too that these people don't talk. They talk constantly. You know, they're all friends with one another, and they all talk and compare numbers and talk about, you know, the different things going on. And so I think to the outside world or to the media, sometimes people, you know, think that it's only this time of year that comparisons are being made, but they're made throughout the year and generally in conversations and several phone calls a week. So to the general public out there, I want them to really understand and have confidence in what we're doing, because this is not just people sitting down. These are months of preparation that, guess what, when it started in January and then into February, it's totally different now. What the budgets looked like back then were really, I mean, I know Dr. Johnson and myself were, you know, we were elated because sales taxes were up for the school system, which relies on them much more than we do. And there was a lot of growth with new homes and whatever. And then we had these, you know, two really devastating events. So I say that because, you know, no budget comes without criticism. There's a lot of things that I think is over the next 2 months is till we get a budget that have to be taken in consideration. And I know our finance people are doing that. So I guess Brent's standing by. Again, I just want to say to Dr. Johnson and to Brent Goldberg, I want to say to you guys publicly, thank you, you know, for all of your cooperation during this budget season. You know, I know the finance team sitting just in the other room feels the same way. We had the discussion this morning, and I want the public to understand that this is done in cooperation and a lot of coordination. And if it weren't for the relationships that they had, then we wouldn't be a county that's AAA bond rated by all of the three top rating agencies in this country. We wouldn't be sitting with the fund balances we have. And guess what? All of us in the school systems realize this last couple of years, we've prepared real well with the fund balances to take us through these times that we're in today. So, Brent, take it away.
All right, I'm going to try to share my screen so we can get started. I think Dr. Johnson's going to do the first part of this, and then I'll jump in.
All right. Well, good morning. Thank you, Mayor, for those opening comments, and I couldn't have said it better in regards to the level of collaboration that that happens at all levels. And good morning, school board members and county commissioners, and obviously anybody that's tuning in. So our district has a strategic plan in which we've really been committed to over the last few years and working to meet the strategic goals, not just the goals, but the key performance indicators that are up under each of those goals. And so this always guides our work. Brent talked a lot last year about priority-based budgeting, and these those are our priorities and how we'll base our budget. To set some context in regards to, you know, what we're really about, it's about improving student achievement. And so it's been well documented and talked about in regards to performance of our schools over this last year, in which we were able to have an end of year assessment, and the work of our teachers. And so, you know, you see in particular that 84%, you know, of our teachers in schools met or exceeded state expectations. And when you compare, if you had an A rating that you looked at for schools, if schools were given letter grades in 16, 17, the year before I arrived, there were five schools that would have received an A. This past school year in 18, 19, we had 32 schools that would have received an A. And that's a 433% increase. And again, just echoes or accentuates the work that's taken place academically within our school system. And we shared this and have really worked to shift this conversation. When I started, we talked about being the fastest improving school district in the state of Tennessee, moving at the rate we did accomplish that goal. And now we've shifted the narrative, but significant movement in our district, in not just student academic growth, but also achievement. And very, very proud of the work, again, that's taking place in our schools. Our budget is based on community feedback. And so, you know, we try to take all levels of feedback in. Last year, the chamber commissioned a study on Velocity 2040 and learning roles as a key theme and education specifically roles as a key theme. As we went out and did our budget sessions or conversations in the community, we'll leave the screen up. I won't necessarily talk through all of these, but we go out into each learning community and try to hear from them from the standpoint of understanding what the community priorities are. We don't sit in a room as a handful of people and try to develop a budget, nor does our board. We really want to engage the community. And this is what we heard from our community members in regards to our strategic plan and where they wanted to see investment. So in setting context based on that, you know, when we look at, you know, really some themes that came out or some areas in which we think it's important to continue to, you know, commit, one in six students has a behavioral developmental disability. And we know that 45% of students have at least one adverse childhood experience. And that could be an incarcerated parent. That could be a very fragile economic situation. And then that one in 10 students in the state of Tennessee have high school students have reportedly attempted suicide. And that was as of 2017. And so, you know, continuing to look at this area and understand that this is students are entering our schools with these challenges. As we've talked to the communities, we've talked to teachers. We know that's a focus. Reading is a focus. Literacy is a focus for us. And so you can see we take fourth grade because there's a national assessment in fourth grade. But you can see how our county ranks at 38.4% and how the state ranks at 34.4%. And then you can see nationally how our state does in comparison to the nation. But all areas, whether you look at us in the state at the state level or you look nationally, you know, everybody when it comes to literacy. And by the way, at all grade bands, it's about in this range. There's a lot of work to be done in regards to making sure that our students are literate and making sure that they can read and speak and listen and articulate what it is they've read. And it's critically important. And another data point that we know is it's important as we look at how students enter. When we look at literacy specifically, 89% of students who are off track for kindergarten readiness are reading below grade level by third grade. So, you know, when they enter off track, you know, they remain off track and vice versa. And so a lot of work to be done in regards to educating our community, continuing to educate our community and parents around what can be done. We've had a commitment to, you know, to teachers and to our employees in general. And you can see just kind of a timeline over the last year of the investments that have been made. We probably should have just this since last evening, but obviously in February, we announced a 2.5% raise for employees. And the important piece there is the fact that we were able to move entry pay to over $41,000. Which was really, really important. And obviously the projections, we'll see how those things come in. And then, you know, when we start talking about the profession of teaching, when you look nationally at what's transpiring within the workforce, you know, in supply and demand, in 1975, about one in four, you know, students that went into a college or university, went into education, today, you can see that less than 4% of students that are going into post-secondary, going into a college, go into the field of education. And so there's a supply decrease, and we've got to be intentional about addressing the supply decrease that we know exists and look at innovative ways to bring teachers into the workforce. The COVID conversation, but you could see that our governor's priorities were definitely teacher pay, literacy and mental health. And you see the correlation. I talked to them about mental health. Obviously, we talk about literacy and we talk about, you know, the need to continue to pay teachers. Our budget and these numbers have continued to grow. This was as of March 14th, but just a complete spike in unemployment claims. That number has continued to balloon over the last several weeks. And obviously, we hope that that does decline. And so the budget that was approved prior to session ending was a revised budget that really have the proposals for teachers and pay. The money that was to be appropriated for mental health was removed. And then they did slash a good chunk of it for literacy, although there still remains some investment there. And you know, as we look at, you know, although COVID-19 has hit us, as we look at the work that that we've done and the trajectory that we want to remain on, we've shifted from becoming the fastest improvement because we accomplished that in a very quick amount of time, in particular for a system this size. And so now our focus on simply becoming the best. And now we'll turn over to Brent to talk through the FY21 budget.
So first, I'll just start with a few highlights. You know, once we got the changes in the state budget, you know, it still included some BEP growth, but a lot of the things were cut, as you saw on the previous screens from the state budget. So the BEP growth was less than we originally anticipated. So when we prepared the original fiscal year 20 budget, we did that with fiscal responsibility in mind, and essentially took last year's budget, and there were very minimal additions to the budget. And a couple of those you can see at the top of your screen are related to investing more in student technology for elementary schools, and then also replacing the laptops that teachers and school administrators use. And of course, you all know with all the virtual learning that we've had to shift to, you know, these investments are important in making sure that teachers and students are able to have access. some of the other highlights would be utilizing $4 million savings related to our healthcare cost due to opening clinics and pharmacies this summer. I think you all are aware, with the county having a clinic and pharmacy, how beneficial that will be to the school system. So we were able to use those dollars to maximize our budget without any additional increases in revenue. And then also, just to highlight, you know, with our priority-based budgeting process, we have lots of requests that we get from departments, schools, principals, the community, and there were more than $65 million worth of requests that we did not include in the budget that just because there's not available funding for some of these things. And then we also cut an additional $1 million from the fiscal year 20 budget through operational efficiencies. And again, just focused on fiscal responsibility with that original budget that we prepared. And then with, you know, things that have changed over the past couple of weeks, you all know that we made some additional cuts to the budget, and those include cutting annual step increases. So it essentially freezes pay for employees where it is currently. And then we've made some cuts to central office, which will include two director level positions. We're freezing all non-teacher hiring and purchasing through June 30th. And then on June 30th, we'll, of course, reevaluate and to see if we need to do anything further. We also originally had proposed some budget increases for vehicle replacement and custodial services, and we're going to put those on hold, which will save us some funds that we had originally budgeted. And in total, that puts us at $4 million in budget cuts from the original budget that we proposed to the school board. And then after last night's meeting, we will put $2.8 million of those cuts directly into fund balance just to create some additional savings. This next slide just shows some examples of the some of the unfunded requests that I mentioned earlier. Dr. Johnson talked through the slide about the teacher supply and demand. The Grow Your Own Teacher Preparation Initiative was something that we had started last year, and then the governor also had funds originally in his budget to ramp that up statewide. Those were subsequently cut from his budget, and then we also cut most of those from funds from our budget as well. We also had some things like Kindergarten Extension Initiative, K-2 Literacy Coordinator, additional special education teachers and assistants. Obviously, increasing capital maintenance is a priority. And you can see on the list, these are just examples of some of the requests that we had during budget this year that we had to cut due to just not having enough funding to get all these things in the budget. So in total, our budget summary, this is the revenue side. It shows we have $418,800,000 revenue budget. You can see which portion is state, which portion is local, and then we have very little funds other than those two sources. The $418,800,000 is the amount that was required to avoid any maintenance of effort issues. And this next slide shows a breakdown by focus area. This ties back to our strategic plan and how we invest the funds throughout our budget. Accelerating student achievement is, of course, more than half the budget, and that does include all of our teacher pay and school level positions in that area. And then just to remind everyone, I know you all know this, but over 78% of our budget is people, and 94% of those people are school-based personnel. You can see the operational staff, which includes like transportation and maintenance, and then our central office staff is 3.5%. In terms of our other funds outside of general purpose funding, all of those funds have no significant changes from the prior year. So our capital maintenance fund, again, will be $3 million as it was last year. And you can see the budgets for school nutrition, federal programs, and self-funded programs. Those are essentially the same as prior year with no significant changes. And last thing I would point to is all of our budget documents. These are all located on our website, and you can see kind of a breakdown of what's included in each budget document. We have details for all of our revenue areas, details by our strategic focus areas, by state function summary, also by organization, which is departmental. Objects is, like the accounting line items. And then we also have a summary of positions in more detail for all of the other funds as well. So with that, that's the end of our presentation. Again, the budget is primarily not much different than last year, other than a few investments in more technology for students and teachers.
Brent, if we could, and then open up the question, just want to give a nod to our teachers as we talk about being the best. We know that we have, you know, approximately 3,200 teachers, educators in our school system, and this is Teacher Appreciation Week. And shared with the board yesterday, we appreciate the work that our teachers do every single day, and even as we've had to adjust to this COVID-19 environment and online learning, very, very proud of the work that has happened really across the system in regard to standing up COVID-19 and frankly, being recognized across the state as a leader in that regard, and look to for insights in regards to what our system was able to do. And there's no larger group that played a role in us being able to shift and be that nimble than that of teachers. So definitely appreciate the work that they do. I think we're open to.
Did we say it's time for questions?
Correct. Questions.
Yeah. Brent, is Brent still on here?
Yes, sir.
Brent, I've got this is Randy Fairbanks. I've got a question for you. On your slide presentation, you said two positions were cut in the central office. I'm just curious, did those individuals slide back into another position, or what happened to those individuals?
Yeah, I can speak to that. We're in the process now. We're in the process now of, and so one of the things I know that we spoke to within the slides is we froze all purchasing and all hiring through June 30th as of Monday. And so we have some vacancies that we've obviously frozen as we work through those two director level positions. Being reduced from the system, we will work to find a placement in a current vacancy for those individuals.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Johnson.
I've got a question. Dr. Johnson, Mayor, Brent, I don't know if I can answer this, but my question is this. Knowing that the legislature's going back into session here in June and are going to make adjustments, I presume, to the budget, to the state budget, which will influence not only our funding, but funding all across the state of Tennessee. Why are we doing this right now, besides other than it's just the tradition that we've always done this in early May? Why do we not wait till after the state legislature meets and see what kind of cuts they have before we give strong consideration to finalizing our own budgets? And Mayor, I guess I'd really direct that to you. You could speak to that challenge.
We
do our budget after they're out of session.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your question, because we have been in contact with the delegation, and I think the chairman called the other day with the finance people from it was Senators Watson, Gardner-Hire, and Patsy Hazelwood, which they serve on finance committees at the state level with our finance team here in Hamilton County, going over some of those particulars that they might be looking at. But know this, and I know the people that are much more qualified to speak to this are obviously the people that run the finances for the Department of Education and for county government. But as you know, Dr. Johnson just say, I mean, there are some mechanisms to put in to try to protect in the event that you get some of these cuts that are unpredictable. But quite frankly, they come at us every year with either. And no one likes to hear the word unfunded mandates, but it's not unusual for state government to come down with less revenue than what we predicted or projected. So Yes, you know, we're doing everything we can to build in our budget. I think, you know, again, with what we've been given a heads up by the delegation, some of the things that they're going to be looking at, but I've not been in conversation with Governor Lee about this because most of our conversations are about COVID and tornadoes right now. But do plan to talk with him, you know, to see what his idea is going forward and how it's going to impact counties. And again, you know, when you look, there's only one piece of that that really concerns me. I mean, the governor committed like $100 million to go out to give the cities and counties. That could be impactful, but you know, we're still working through that, and Brent may have something, or Dr. Johnson, that he wants to add, but he's already had some of his cuts talked about.
Commissioner, as the mayor spoke to, I mean, we're in unknown times, unprecedented times, and I think you know, when you look at a budget, the way we approach a budget's a fluid document, and you know, we work to be proactive and responsive with our budget. I think the mayor spoke to earlier, and Brent and finance, Alan Leake, and I speak to this better than I agree, but it's always a projection. You know, you're always projecting. You rather project, you know, you want to be aggressive with your projections, but you always want to be under budget. And we've had the fortune over the last several years, you know, we always have to come back and amend our budget and make decisions. Fortunately, a lot of times we're amending our budget, you know, in the direction of, you know, we've got more revenue than we, you know, maybe anticipated and able to do some different things. But fully, I wouldn't necessarily say anticipate because that's probably too strong a word, but are absolutely preparing for, you know, having to amend the other way. And we'll, you know, we'll have to cross that bridge, you know, as we get there for sure on our end.
Hey, it's Chip, that answered actually my question. What if we kind of grossly miscalculate our revenue projections? And that's good to know that if we have to amend, we do so. Question, kind of a little sidebar, what's being planned, what's going to happen with East Brainerd Elementary? What are the plans for that?
Yeah, so we're in the process right now. So you know, I take it back. We you know, $18 million in damage to rebuild that school. The insurance, you know, we'll cover that as well as some cost for the time in which we have to set up in another place. So really, there was three options that existed for us. Option one, you know, is to, which is the least favorable, is to kind of spread students out across multiple schools. When you look at schools that are in pretty close proximity, there's only something like 300 seats available. And we know that's a, you know, 1,100 plus student school. And so, you know, that you'd end up literally having to spread elementary age students across the system. So that really isn't an option. The second option that we're approaching, and frankly, you know, it's becoming less and less probable or possible that it could happen. But we have been sourcing available buildings for lease and such, and in the area, and have not identified one as of yet, but have been to several sites where buildings are standing to see if there's something that we could make modifications to that could serve as a school. And I should also mention the timeline. We expect it to be December, but you know, when you get into a building that's had the type of damage that building has had, you know, you start pulling back layers. You know, it could be worse. And so, you know, we're looking at this as a situation where in a perfect world, we get students back in that school in January. In an imperfect world, you know, you're looking at August of 21. And so then the other option that really exists, and you know, you still have to do some things to make it happen, is East Hamilton Middle, which will be opened on time. In order to do that, you probably got to put some modular classrooms on a campus or two, and work through some logistical things to make that happen. So option two of looking at a different location, and option three of using East Hamilton Middle are the most viable options currently that we're sourcing.
Thank you.
I don't know if this is necessarily a question, but things that I wanted to mention that I've noticed through the presentation is, for one, thank you, Dr. Johnson, for acknowledging that this is National Teacher Appreciation Week. You know, in these times that we're experiencing right now, I know I, for one, with three children at home, really appreciate our teachers. And am eager for them to get back in the classroom. It's certainly had an effect here on our lives, and I know many others across the county. You know, as we've gone into this budget, and there's so many unknowns. I mean, as there always are, but particularly today, with how COVID-19 is affecting our communities. It's a real challenge to think about, you know, and I certainly am appreciative that, you know, we've been able to address in Hamilton County teacher compensation throughout the year last year in some creative ways, and the flexibility there, I believe, has been appreciated. But, you know, I also noticed, you know, that a lot of the savings that we're finding in the budget actually comes from teachers with regards to the benefit lines. And, you know, as we learn more about what the future has for us, I just want to be outspoken in the fact that, you know, I hope, as I know many of you are, you know, thinking that, you know, we need to make sure and take care of these teachers when we have a clearer picture as to what it is we're going to be looking at. You know, as demand increases and supply decreases, it creates that, you know, paradox where we really need to be investing in teachers. And I believe much of that is evidenced by how teacher compensation, not only here in Hamilton County, but across the country, has not kept up with inflation over the past couple of decades. And it's really important for me and for our community that we don't let that get ahead of us. So any more than it has. So thank you all very much. That's really all I wanted to say. Thank you, guys.
This is Commissioner Jeter. I just wanted to make a comment. First, thank you to Superintendent Johnson and to your administration for a job well done in terms of the budget, and also really a job well done in how you transitioned our school system in the midst of this pandemic. I know that that was not an easy task, but from where I have sat, looking from the community standpoint, you guys have truly done it with excellence. And I just want to say on behalf of District 5, thank you so much for that. And reviewing the budget and just kind of hearing some of the comments and really piggyback off and what Commissioner Sharp just mentioned in terms of not losing focus and investing in our teachers, I guess something that I would also encourage us to not lose focus on is that realizing the state that we are in, and we are in a very critical point here when it comes to our economy and our budget and how we fund right now and going forward. But looking at it and knowing that another huge cut, at least for me and for the students that reside not only in District 5, but keep in mind all of our districts in Hamilton County, is we're losing additional social workers and school counselors. And I don't have to say to each person here and those that are not that serve on the school board and on the commission that, you know, the trauma and the impact that COVID-19 has had and will be long lasting. And so the fact that we already had huge disparities in these areas of schools, every school not having a social worker, not having school counselors, and the huge impact that barrier existing in our schools had on our teachers prior to COVID, and now that it's going to be for our teachers after COVID, is a great concern. And so again, just reiterate what Commissioner Sharp said, the investment that we have for our teachers, I really encourage that we can't lose focus. Our teachers here in Hamilton County have always stepped up, but they really have stepped up during this COVID to play a huge role in not only continuing to educate at the best level that they could under the circumstances, but also to deal with the emotional impact that this virus has had on our community. And I don't have to say, you know, some of our communities are not equal in terms of the effect that this virus has had. So again, Dr. Johnson, just thank you so much for what you guys have always done and continue to do.
This is Commissioner Fairbanks. I would like to say something. I think Dr. Johnson and his team and the mayor and his team are doing the right thing to get out front and get something on paper as far as a budget goes. We've often heard how many, many hours they work on these budgets. And for us to take the attitude at this point to say, hey, well, let's wait and see what the state's going to do. Let's wait and see what our revenues are going to do would put us way, way too far behind the eight ball to try to do a budget. So I think the steps you're taking to go with your best, hate to call it a guess, but go with your best thoughts right now on what it should be and get something down. And then as some figures come in or something, if we have to do some adjustments, we do those adjustments. But I think to wait would put us so far behind the eight ball that we wouldn't be able to catch up when we finally do have figures come in. So I appreciate Dr. Johnson and his finance team and then our finance people that work for the mayor going ahead and getting on board.
If I could, I'd like to add something to that. Because again, thank you, Chairman Fairbanks. What we've been directed by the comptroller from the state of Tennessee, and as has the other 94 counties, is that we need to have a budget passed by the end of June, by June 30th. And what they've recommended to us is, like any budget, this one is kind of exceptional because of the different disasters, but what the comptroller directed was and sent a letter to all counties saying, we want you to get a budget passed by June 30th. If you have to make any amendments, that's what budgets are for. If you have to amend them, I don't think we've ever had a Department of Education budget didn't have to be amended because, you know, fortunately, usually the revenues turn out to be more. So they have to be accounted for. That happens with us as the commission's being gracious enough, we amend the budget constantly when we get additional grant money or whatever. As you know, I mean, it's, you know, that's the time when you scrutinize, you know, why it's being amended and you know, what the projections that might not have met what we thought. But again, we're being encouraged by the state, by the comptroller to put this budget together, as is the other counties, and have it submitted by the 30th of June.
Mayor, in education, you wait. As a teacher, I was trained that you wait for questions and you give a long pause as long as the pause takes. But I don't think in a budget presentation you have to give any pause. I don't think there's any more questions there.
That would be – that's a good thing if there's not. Are there any more questions before we sign off? If not, you know, again, thank you to everyone that's on this this.
I think Mac is doing this. He's muted.
Hey, Mayor. Can I come in?
Absolutely.
Okay. I've listened to the superintendent. He alluded to the level of preparation of these students. I think he said one out of every six students have a parent who have been in jail or have some kind of trouble. And I looked and heard him allude to the number of counselors and others who have been cut. Having said that, the numbers, system performed very, very well last year in spite of all of that. And listening to Brent and the superintendent and the mayor, I think you all have your thumb on the pulse of the people. Listening to the other commissioners, they too recognize that we're in a troubled period. And it just seems like the superintendent and his staff and the mayor, you all are on the right track. And you're being realistic in terms of what we can do. So I simply encourage you to continue to do what you're doing. Thank you.
Thank you. I do have, I'm getting some notes handed to me. From Lee Browner, of course, all over the Lee can take and get these notes. The important point is to the commission. I think you're telling me it's going to be next Wednesday. Next Wednesday. Yeah, you said it to me. I can't read his writing. So I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn this thing. I have social distance myself for Lee. For a number of reasons, but I'm gonna step aside and let Lee.
Okay, just very quickly, this is for the county commissioners. We've got budget hearings available, or they're for the supported agencies and the constitutional officers that are requesting budget increases will be held after the commission meeting. I believe they're scheduled at 1 o'clock on May 13th. The only information available is we've got in SERP all the attacks that we need to review before that meeting are available now. So if you want to go out to SERP, you can download all the attachments for that hearing. So that's it.
Anybody have any questions about that from the commission? All right, any other questions? Sign off.
Let me say one thing, Mayor. Our plan there is, commissioners, to meet virtually a regular meeting that morning like we normally do, and then depending on the time frame there, we will completely sign off and then come back on at 1 o'clock. So there'll be a break between our commission meeting and those hearings there. And let me say, before we do get off here, I wanted to at least mention that I've got several commissioners on here today with us, but Commissioner Boyd did contact me this morning and let me know because of work issues that he would not be on the conference today. So he let me know that. Thank you, Mayor.
Mayor, thank you for sharing with us. We appreciate it. And Mr. Chairman, we also appreciate very much our teachers, as several have said.
Goodbye.
I'm muted. Anything else? And we're about ready to close. Anything else?
Yeah, real quick. I want to make sure I've got the schedule down. Are we meeting next Tuesday at 9 and the next day at 1? 13th. So 12th at 9 and the 13th at 1. Is that correct?
No. The 13th, we will meet at 9/9:30, our regular commission meeting on the 13th. And then we will come back on the 12th. Do what?
No meetings on the 12th at 9.
Yes, there is, isn't there, Mayor? That's the budget meeting.
Okay, so we'll meet at 9 on the 12th and the 13th at 9:30 and then 1.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Mr. Chairman, I know you got enough issues without me confused in your meeting, so. I'm sorry, he says I'm on mute. So. Was on mute. Mr. Chairman, I don't want to confuse anybody with your meeting. So you want to, again, go through the Tuesday and Wednesday, what's going to happen? I mean, the Wednesday's a regular scheduled meeting. And then at 1 o'clock, is that when you hear the different agencies?
Yes. That is correct. We will come back at 1 o'clock and come back on and hear the agencies. After our regular scheduled commission meeting that morning at 9:30.
Okay. Anyone else? Again, thank you to everyone that participated today, and thank you to all of our school board members, commissioners, and certainly to Dr. Johnson and Brent Goldberg for putting together a budget that we're hopefully ready to act on. And again, we'll be signing off until next week. Well, actually, the commission will be next. Yeah, I need to say next Tuesday. At 9 o'clock, we'll be doing this again. On the county government, general government portion.